Hey, BG Squad, on this week's Open and Honest, you know, we wanted to speak with a Canadian legend, a hip-hop legend. And I honestly, I don't think I got to say anything else except for his name. Kardinal Offishall.
Yeah, we don't say you know what I'm saying. T-Dot says you don't know.
Oh, me, oh, my eyes.
President, pull anywhere you go on earth because you're beautiful. Okay.
Kardi, you ready to go?
Come on, brother. Born ready.
Born ready. You got the hat. You got the drip.
Man, this is bedroom drip, but we'll go with it. You know what I mean?
I hear you. Still looking fresh, though. Thanks so much for joining us. I just want to ask you off the top, okay? Yeah. Off the top. This year has been wild. This past year has been wild. It still feels wild, but how are you doing? How have you been coping?
It's not an easy question to answer, bro. You know what I'm saying? I think because of my belief system and what I've been through, navigating and remaining, I've been living in gratitude. It's been tough, man. It's been tough because it's like, tough from the standpoint of like, I'm so used to interacting with humans, you know what I'm saying? Like a lot of what we do is feeding off of the good energy from the crowd, from the fans you meet, traveling, having amazing, even some of the, going to a different city and having business meetings over a foreign meal. Like usually I'm somebody that's projecting, but now it's kind of like I'm looking inward, you understand?
So what have you found about yourself?
That I don't give myself enough credit. You know what I'm saying? I find that I spend a good amount of my time trying to make sure other people are good. You know what I mean? Trying to bring up the new artists, whether it's, at my executive job at Universal. I discovered I'm an empath. So a lot of what I love to do is to make sure that other people are good. You know what I'm saying? To shine a light on other people. But I also realize that, I haven't, as much as I probably should, I haven't paid enough attention to myself.
Kardi, I want to talk about giving yourself credit because from the outside, I feel like everybody knows you're the OG. You know what I mean? Like you paved the path for so many people who are coming up now who've already came up, So when you look back at your career, what's one of the highlights for you?
The amount of different things that I experienced, Bergen, it's like looking back now, it's something to feel proud of. But at the same time, there's a part of me that's a little bit sad because I'm like, man, like I really should have soaked it up at that time. Yeah.
So do you have a favorite song of your own?
No.
So which one will you always remember making? Like which one will always stand out for you? Which song will always stand out for you?
I'll tell you the honest truth. The song that I had one of the best experiences making is one of the songs that I hate the most. So when I made Belly Dancer with Pharrell, right?
Hey! A belly dancer, a snake charmer, a belly dancer, a snake charmer.
Now this is after we did the Grindin' remix, which was like a dream come true. When I met Pharrell, he was a fan of Old Time Killing. He loved it. And at the time I was loving Grindin' from the clips. And I told him that. And he's like, yo, we're about to do this remix. I would love to get you, love to get you on this remix. And I was just like, all right, bro. Like that's just industry talk. People say that all the time. But back then times, it wasn't like there was an email or something. The man FedEx me a hard copy of the Pro Tools. You understand? And the Grindin' remix, I put that in the machine, wrote my thing, recorded it. The whole thing was done within 20 minutes. From that remix, like it was so important to be a part of that at that time because it literally was like the biggest hip hop song that was out at the time. So it was a massive look, but it was from that Pharrell was like, yo, I have to work with you on your album. I have to. And we were like, all right, cool. Like, what are you gonna tell Pharrell no?
Can I ask you this? Like, why do Canadian artists, rappers have to go to the States to blow up? Why can't, I feel like we're starting to see a change now, where they can, you know, where our artists can stay here in Canada. But you think they still need to go to the States?
It's not even about the States. It's unfortunately, we still don't have the infrastructure that we need here.
But what do you mean by infrastructure?
I mean, for Black music, we don't have the support needed from radio, from television, from media, you know, award shows.
How does that feel? What does that feel like as an artist, knowing that you have to leave?
It doesn't feel good at all, bro. Listen, all right, Dangerous was the most obvious thing, and there's a lot to it, right?
Bigger head, good body shape. Yeah. When she on the dance floor, girl, am I rage. When she do her thing, man can't walk straight. That miss keep you soak up everything on her plate.
The maddest, and most disappointing thing is that, yo, Dangerous, took off, and within a couple of weeks, it was in the Hot 100 on Billboard. I think within the third week, it was within the top 40. Like, it was moving lightning quick. But the thing is that Canada didn't even mention it until it was already gone clear. We have some of the biggest exports the world has ever seen. But the thing is, if you look at Drake, if you look at Jesse Reyes, if you look at The Weeknd, if you look at Bieber, on and on and on, even to myself, we all had to go outside of Canada to get a deal.
Tell us the top three artists, rappers or R&B artists that you're listening to that we should be watching out for. Or maybe top five.
I would say Savannah Ray for sure.
Yeah.
I would say Toby. I would say Emmanuel without question. A youth named Zach Zoya. You know what? Going for a wild card. Shout out to my homegirl, Majo.
I'm on TikTok. I know you're now on TikTok as well. Dangerous is like having this resurgence.
Stop myself from looking and noticing you, noticing me. Watch out, I've seen a type before. That girl is so dangerous.
The interesting thing is that the TikTok Dangerous thing blowing has shifted the way that I've looked at TikTok, but it's also given me a greater understanding of what's really happening within our society right now. You've had catalog tracks, which are, you know, 18 months and older. Those are considered catalog. And then you have the brand new stuff. And it's usually been the two lanes. And it's good that you said resurgence, is you're having the kind of a third lane now to where there's these tracks that are resurgent songs that for me and you, it might be nostalgic, but for a whole generation, they're brand new songs.
Right.
So what's happening is it's starting to not only generate new revenue for these songs. For me, it's amazing because people are like, yo, I love this song. Kardi Wagwan, where's the new tune? And then, there's a song that's by the time this interview is out, there's a song called Freedom Heights that's out. And it actually features myself, Savannah Ray, Emmanuel.
Okay.
The Queen Julie Black. And then, originally from Texas, but she's in LA now, my homegirl, Susan Carroll. All of the money from that song, all the royalties are going towards the NIA Center here in Canada. So all that will go towards, helping them build that center, which will hopefully be Canada's first Black live space.
Honestly, thanks for taking the time to speak with us and to dive deeper. There were so many more questions that I had for you, but that just means you're going to have to come back on the show.
Big up and blessings from me and mine. You know what I'm saying?
Thank you so much, Kardi. Promise me we'll talk soon, okay?
Anytime, brother. Anytime.
Nah, he's a real one. Cardi's a real one. And you know this, I just want everybody to know that we're going to continue having great and big guests throughout the remainder of the season. So keep it locked. Okay. It's time for good news.